إن الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فهو المهتدي، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، my dear brothers and my sisters, all the hamd is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sole creator and owner of this universe and all that it contains. He is the one that has created everything, and everything needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is as-samad, the independent from anything else that is of his creation. In these days and age, Islam has become something of a spread. It's taken as a face value in English. We hear a lot of people today when they say, for example, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And now it no longer is sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Somebody somewhere down the line had translated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by peace be upon him. We hear a lot of people saying that. In the old days, some of them are dead. Today we hear some celebrities like Zaki Naik and Sheikh Ahmed did that, and a few other speakers, they go of peace be upon him. And now the general public hears peace be upon him, and it has become something of a given fact. Also, you see people saying Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and then they translate it into in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. But is this what Islam is all about, the translations of this? Let me tell you and share with you a reality about these translations today. Islam, as stated in Al-Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is in Arabic. It's a language of Arabic. The book is in Arabic. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in Arabic. What protects this Islam from the kufr and the shirk is Arabic. The translations, as said by the scholars of nowadays, Hayat al-Kibar al-Ulama in Saudi Arabia, the greatest council of fatawa by Ibn Baz and Ibn Uthaymin al-Fawzan and all these great scholars, when they were asked about the translations of Al-Quran, they said there is nothing called translation of Al-Quran because you cannot translate Al-Quran. For Al-Quran has an endless meaning form. It can take so many different forms. So what you are translating is one of the various meanings of Al-Quran, and they put conditions as to when the Quran can be read in English, i.e. the meanings of Al-Quran. It is to present it to the new Muslim people. In the old day, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when they took Islam to the world, and that is as far as Indonesia, and as I said before, in Egypt, North Africa, midst of Africa, and even Spain, they took the Islam and the Quran in Arabic. They did not translate it to people. They just gave it to them as it was. People had to learn Arabic, and they did learn Arabic. Look, for example, Egypt, Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, Mauritania, and many countries, Somalia, Eritrea, and all these countries, and add to that Palestine, Syria, Lebanon, and part of Iran, and all these countries did not speak Arabic. But when they embraced Islam, as-Sahaba did not want to jeopardize this religion by giving it another language. And as such, all these people became Muslims, and Islam stayed with them until today. 1400 years later, Islam is with them. The same wasn't done by Muslims when they went to Spain. When Muslims spent 800 years and more in Spain, instead of teaching the Spaniards how to speak Arabic, they translated and they played with Islam to make it accessible to the people. For 800 years, the Muslims didn't take the time to learn Arabic. Then when the Spaniard or the Spanish got into a revolt and kicked the Muslims, there is nothing of Islam left in Spain. The same thing is happening here in the West, my dear brothers and my sisters. Back in the early 90s, the priest or the great cardinal of Canterbury was asked, and I heard this by my own ears on the radio, when he was asked about the Muslims, he said, as long as they are in our schools, we shouldn't be afraid of them. And he is correct, because today, look at the Muslims, how they are today. The British government is extremely intelligent and extremely clever. Is not going to oppose Islam right headlong, because they know through history that they cannot win. But they are good at working behind the scenes. Islam is being today weakened. So many people today, either willfully or unwillfully, are helping this great conspiracy at Englishizing Islam. The way the British and the West work with Islam, because we live in the West, and we have become part of the West, they cannot genocide us. They cannot get rid of us in one go. So what happens is they need to curb this growth of Islam in Europe. Believe it or not, Europe is a state, a country of not Islam. They don't want Islam. And there are movements after movements, and it's going to get worse in the future. The more Islam gets stronger and the more we become a great number, the more there will be an opposition. And this is exactly what happened to the children of Israel. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us the story of the children of Israel and how they were slaughtered, because there, as soon as Fir'aun saw that his throne was challenged by only one person of the children of Israel, he declared war on their gender and everything that was Jews, and he wanted to annihilate them. The same thing here in the West. That it just needs a vision, and that's it. We all will pay the price. But today the price in England is that they are helping people to take Islam away from the Arabic, just like the Bible was taken away from its original context and language, Aramaic. Look at what happened to the Bible here. Look at the sequence of the Bible and watch how the Quran is being taken, and it's not the Arabic. But what's happening in the West is exactly what's happening to Al-Quran now, to Islam now, is exactly what happened to the Bible. The Bible was in Aramaic. The Jews didn't accept Isa alayhi salam. What did the Romans do? They took the religion of Isa alayhi salam, Jesus son of Mary, and they took it to Rome. And it got translated. Rome, that is the East, I'm talking more Constantinople and Kaiser and all these things in the Eastern. And they translated to what? To the Latin. And then in the translation of the Latin, that's where the meanings got lost. Let me tell you a little bit how the translation took place. At the beginning, before anything happened, the monks used to write their Latin words on top of the Aramaic. Like today in the Arabic, when you say a word, وَدَخَلَ الْمَدِينَ, and on top of دَخَلَ, they would write entered city. They would put a meaning to a meaning on top. So that to make it easy, like you find in Urdu, like you find today in English, where they have the ayah on one side and the English on the other side. They would put that there. And then with time, they were having big manuscripts of something written in Hebrew, in Aramaic, and on top of it, of Latin. Then they came up with this idea, hang on here, why are we taking so much space? Let the book in Aramaic stay to the left, and let us now study what is written in Latin, since it is the same meaning. And people started concentrating on the Latin, and books started written about the Latin, and people started studying the Latin, and the Aramaic got disregarded slowly, 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 until it went all the way through. For hundreds of years, Europe and the West and the East were preaching the Bible in Latin. They could not say it in Hebrew. And now, even in England, like 100 years ago, Latin was predominant. And some old English was used as the English Quran is used today. It's just to give you an idea about the meaning. Then gradually, people start getting sick and tired. We do not understand Latin anyway. We don't speak Latin anyway, so why is it there? Give us something in English and we will work with it. And that's how the original text, Aramaic, got disregarded for Latin. And Latin got disregarded for any variety of languages, French, Arabic, English, German, Italian, and so on and so forth. In the old days, I'll tell you about how the Bible got translated into English. Just this is briefly, because this is a khutbah and I don't want to make it as a lesson. The old English translations was before 1066, and that is around 950 years ago. Prior to that, 950 years ago, 9 centuries and a half ago, the Bible was in Latin with words written on top of the Latin to give meanings. Then the Old English, the very first Bible that was translated, was in around 1066, and the Old English was used, just like that of Yusuf Ali that he used with the Quran, exactly the same Old English. And then the Middle English was between 1066 until 1500. And that's when they started using the Middle English to make it easy for people to read the Bible. The Latin was completely absent. It was in separate books, and people started relying on half Latin, half English. And then the early modern English translations of the Bible were between the 1500 and the 1800. That is about 300 years ago. And the modern English today that we have today came from 1800 until now. And every year, the International Revised Version, the Bible gets reviewed for fine-tuning and everything. Now, if we look at how the Bible is today and how it was 950 years ago, it is impossible to say they are the same. They are totally different. They have some meanings, but they are different. Now, if we go back to how it were Latin before, and then 2,000 years ago, and then it's going to be unbelievably different. If we go back to the original context of Isa alayhi salam, the Aramaic that he spoke, we're going to be mesmerized at how different the Bible is. And the same thing happened also to the modern Jewish language was from 1853 until now. Before that, there was the old Jewish, and they went through all these transformations, so to speak. Now, the very first time Al-Quran has always been in Arabic. It never was something that the Muslims would translate the meanings of their book into another language. It was not an option. The very first big translation that took place really is by somebody called Alexander Ross, and that was in 1649. He called his very first translation the Al-Quran of Mahomet. He translated from Arabic, then any subsequent translations of the meanings, and he translated into Latin. Then from that Latin, it got translated into different languages. And this is the Quran, I'm talking about the Quran. And every single translation since that time there, done by the Orientalists, i.e. the Western scholars, was done through the Latin, not the Arabic. So they were translating what Alexander Ross had translated. They were not Arabic. I repeat, when the scholars, the Orientalist scholars, translated what they called the Quran, they did not look into the Quran in Arabic, but they more so looked into what Alexander Ross translated into Latin in 1649. In 1734, a great scholar whose books, again translation, has been reprinted in 2007 and is reprinted every single year, and that is George Sale. This George Sale was the very first one to translate the meanings of Al-Quran from the Arabic to the English. Arabic to English, no Latin. And he also did include in it the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, of Al-Tabari, of Al-Qurtubi, and all these things. And he did it to one of his friends, Lord Cabaret, just because he told him to do something for the English people to understand these people in the far east, or the Middle East, because England was more interested in conquering those Bedouins in that land there. After he finished his translations, and he traveled to the land and he spoke Arabic and he really got to know the Arabs from right to left, he wrote this interesting letter to this Lord here telling him, as Muhammad gave his Arabs the best religion he could. Now pay attention. This is what they believe. He said, as Muhammad gave his Arabs the best religion he could, preferable at least to those of ancient pagan lawyers, lawmakers. What he said is, the Arabs were following some pagan law made by other people. Muhammad did his good job at giving these Arabs a law that was better than the other ones. And then he said to him, I confess, I cannot see why he deserves not equal respect, though not with Moses or Jesus Christ, whose law come really from heaven. So what he's saying is this: Moses and Jesus are true prophets and they have received the revelation from heaven, and there is no problem with that. But Muhammad is a man who made the laws for the Arabs to replace the pagan laws. And as such, since he has done a great job at curbing the banditries of the Arabs and the horrible state they were in, this man deserves respect, but not equal to that of Moses or Jesus, because these two latter, Moses and Jesus, are true prophet. And then this is what it is. Now, the Quran is the same thing. When Muslims started working with this, most of the translations into English started in India. Back then, India was Bangladesh and Pakistan, and they were all together. And those who started these translations were not of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, but more so of the Shia groups. They started working on presenting the text into English of the Quran. And thus, that is how the very first books of translation of the meaning of the Quran started. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه سبحانه وتعالى ونتوكل عليه. And we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to direct us to the right of the guidance. Now, my dear brothers and my sisters, Islam is not what has happened to Christianity. Islam is going through the same process. Even though William Tyndale, the man who was between 1494 to 1536, is the man that they refer to and they say is the first man that has translated the Bible into English. Now look at Islam today, what it is going through it. Back 200 years ago, about 150 years ago, scholars or some people that claim scholarship started translating the meanings of the Quran. Calamities happened there. And then gradually, every time somebody come until we got to today. A lot of Arab Muslims today think that Islam is in English. You hear them, they say the Prophet, and if they understood that An-Nabi does not mean the Prophet, they would not utter the word Prophet. But in any case, they say peace be upon him as a substitute to Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I'll ask you a question. In Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that is the name of Allah in the dua. Peace be upon him. Where is the Allah in that? Completely removed. Today they say the Prophet, peace be upon him, and they translate into PBUH. And as I said before, these abbreviations are not permitted in Islam. Also, they say Assalamu alaikum, peace be upon you. Who told you that Assalam is peace? How did you end up with this peace? Let me tell you what the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Peace is a noun of Allah. It's a name of Allah. In the early days, the groups that have deviated and became, wal'iyadu billah, deviated and people of innovation, they deviated mostly because of the misuse of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They gave the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala different meanings. To give you an idea of the dangers of translating Islam and translating the names of Allah, I'll give you an example. If, for example, I take the name of Khadija, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are so many Khadijas on earth today. And the reason why we name our daughters Khadija is because of the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But do you know what exactly means Khadija? I'll tell you what Khadija means. Khadija means any newborn, either of a human or animal, any baby that is born premature. So Khadija, when we say hadhihi bintun Khadija, when we say this daughter is Khadija, we mean that this daughter, this girl here, is born premature. If an animal gives a birth to its baby prematurely, that is Khadija. So can I now, from now on, call the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam the premature baby? Does that make sense? It doesn't make sense at all. The same thing, another example, the name Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu. What does عمر mean? عمر comes from العمر, the age of the person. So when the baby is born, they make a dua, عمر, meaning may Allah give him a long life. So now I am going to call عمر ibn al-Khattab, may Allah give him a long life. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. Take the meaning of the name Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. Uthman is the baby of a snake. So am I going to call him now the baby of a snake? You can see how translations have taken Islam out of proportion. People today, they say Alhamdulillah, it means praise be to Allah. It does not mean praise be to Allah. As-salam, the name of Allah, does not mean peace. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not mean peace be upon him. Every time you say peace be upon him, you get a sin. Because A, you are lying. That is not the meaning. Allah in Al-Quran says, Sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. You mean, that's why the Sahaba said, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his life. And that is a sunnah approved, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why do you translate Islam? Why are you Englishizing Islam? Why are you contributing to the Bible? The other day, I was in a house for working with a couple, and I asked them, do you have a Quran? And the woman goes up and brought me a scary book, everything written in it in English. And at the top of it, it's written the Holy Quran in English. And I nearly fainted. I said, this is not Quran. This is a rubbish translation of one of the meanings of Al-Quran. Al-Quran came in Arabic. You gotta recite it in Arabic. You got to understand it in Arabic. And you have to say, Assalamu alaikum, not salams. How many salams is that? How many salams? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the authentic hadith, As-salamu ismun min asma'illah. This hadith is in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, is in the books of the Sunnah, and it is an authentic hadith. As-salam is a name of the names of Allah he put on earth for you, spread it amongst you. It doesn't mean the peace. Allah's name is not the peace. Allah's name is not the most merciful. Allah's name is not the most gracious. Allah's name is not the most forgiving. Allah's name is not this and that. Allah's name are Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin, Al-Aziz. These are his names. We're not going to start calling people the premature baby for Khadija. We're not going to call Umar, may Allah give him a long life. And we're not going to call Uthman the baby of a snake. My brothers and my sisters, anyone who is not deliberately learning Arabic and relies on English and only translates things into English so that it fits his or her agenda. People who keep saying, peace be upon you. People who are today promoting the evil of translation are contributing to what's going to happen to Al-Quran in 100 years from now. 100 years from now, our kids will not be able to read Arabic. 100 years from now, our kids will rely just exactly like the Christians are relying on so many different versions of their Bible. I remember once, back in like 30 years ago, I was against the Ahmed Didat alayhi rahmatullah style of confronting the Christians, because the Quran didn't say that. And if Allah wanted to prove the Christians and the Jews wrong, he could have sent the honest and the authentic Bible and Injil and the Torah at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would have showed it to them and end of it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't tell them, you have the... No, that is not my job to tell people you're wrong here, you're wrong there. And I remember once they take one of the verses of the Bible and they go, in this version here, Jesus said, and in that version there, Jesus said, and in that version there, you took off that word. So which version do I choose? And people, Muslims, people go and clap their hands and cheering up, yeah, yeah, yeah. And you know what? Prepare for what's coming up in the next 20 to 30 years. Many Muslims are going to become atheists. And I tell you why, and I will tell you to do it now. Because now, if you go on the internet, go for example to alquran.com website, put in ayah, it's a beautiful website, and they have 6 translations of the meaning. Every time you take one ayah, the translations are never the same. So any Christian now takes a these books and prints those six translations of the books of the Quran, and then he comes to you and says to you, you believe in the Quran? You go, of course Islam is the truth and Quran, blah blah, and you don't know a word of Arabic, you don't even understand what you read. And then he tells you, why in this verse, because you call it verse also like him, and it's not permitted in Islam to call an ayah of the Quran verse and to call a surah a chapter. It's not permitted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا نُنزِل مِنْ آيَةٍ. Ayah is what you must refer to the Quran, not verses. Verses are for poetry, and the Quran is not poetry. But in any way, if this man brings you, or this Quran here, the meanings of the Quran, he tells you, in the Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 1, and he's going to tell you a verse, number, it says this, and in this translation it says this, and in that translation it says this, and in this translation it says that. Yusuf Ali says this, Pictor says this, Sahih International says that, Dr. Ghali says this, Muhammad Pictor says this, this says that. Which of these will I believe? How? Your children, you teach them Quran, they don't know Arabic. You don't know Arabic. Why are you helping the Quran to go through the same fate as the Bible? And it will happen in the West. Today, look at it. A lot of Muslims today don't speak Arabic. But they took time to graduate from the university. They took time to learn about this life. They have been Muslims for 20 years. But to learn Arabic, no. Why? Because they become lenient on the translations. And they think, and wrongly so, that Al-Islam is in English. And that is a great, huge calamity. This khutbah here is really to open your eyes. That what you got in English is not what Islam is. And I have said before, Islam is the real meat you eat. What you get in English is a faro copy of that meat. That is not. Islam is in Arabic. You have to go back to the Arabic. If you keep going on in the English, in front of Allah, I will make you. And I will make you bear the consequences of what's going to happen to Muslims in the next 10 to 20 years, when every Muslim wouldn't know how to say Alhamdulillah, and everything becomes praise be to Allah. And then we become just like the Christians. We actually don't know nothing at all. We have one subject, 600 translations. Muslims today here are so confused about what kind of Islam they want. For the love of Allah, fear Allah. Learn Arabic before you go into the qabr. Don't let anyone tell you Arabic is difficult. Not. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّنَّ الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. Al-Quran is easy to learn, is easy to understand, is easy to mention, is easy to practice. But is there anyone that is going to respond to that? This is where the big question is, how serious are you about your Islam? If you only speak English, you have no right whatsoever to preach Islam. Arabicless Islam is vile. Arabicless Islam is danger. Arabicless Islam hurts, and it will hurt you soon or later. This khutbah is an eye-opener, and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the tawfiq and the help to learn Arabic and start being a Muslim as Allah wants it. Quran and Arabian Mubin. That is what it is. It's a Quran, Arabi, and it is explicit. You don't need 16,000 different translations. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وارحمنا وتقبل منا وصل اللهم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وأقم الصلاة.